similar resolution does not have any impact on the competence of Security Council to request the advisory opinion. And my third argument through my first submission is that the question presented before the court is a legal one. Your Excellencies, in regards to my first argument, that is the request was made by a duly authorized organ, it has been expressly mentioned in Article 96.1 of the UN Charter and Article 65.1 of the ICJ Statute that the Security Council or the General Assembly may request advisory opinion on any legal question if it's a specialized agency under the United Nations. Then the requesting organ, the specialized agency, has to form a question that is within the mandate of that specialized agency. If it's General Assembly or the Security Council, then they have a broad competence in comparison to the specialized agencies. So, also under Article 24 of the UN Charter, the Security Council has a broad mandate for maintenance of international peace and security, and has held in 1996 the nuclear weapon case by this very court. There are two elements that needs to be fulfilled for an organ to request advisory opinion. The first one is that the organ has to be duly authorized, and the second one is the question posed to the court must be a legal one. In the question that has been referred by Security Council before this Honorable Court, it has been reiterated by the Presidents of the International Court of Justice as well, and the Secretary General Boutros Ghali in 1990 in his agenda for peace to utilize the organs of United Nations, and he emphasized mainly on the fact that UN organs turn to the court more often for advisory opinion. So the crisis that is prevalent in the present context is such that the Security Council deemed it necessary to seek an advisory opinion so that the legal issues and the laws and the principles that are prevalent are properly applicable, and the International Court of Justice can help to clarify these points in regards to climate change. If we look at the moot problem, it has been explicitly mentioned in paragraph number 12 of the compromise that the Security Council had initiated from 2007, calling for a long-term global response to deal with climate change. Also, the Secretary General of UN said that projected climate changes could not only have serious environmental, social and economic implications, but implications for peace and security as well. This was said by the Secretary General himself. So he also outlined the alarming situation that was prevalent, and also the issue of rendering advisory opinion, requesting advisory opinion for the International Court of Justice was supported by the island nations as well, Republic of Moldova. And one of the member of Security Council as well as one of the island nation also supported the intervention of Security Council in the matter, as they deemed it necessary for the maintenance of international peace and security. My second argument is the fact that GA defeated a particular resolution which was similar to the one that has been requested by the Security Council does not have any impact on the competence of Security Council to request that opinion. It was held in 1971 Namibia Advisory Opinion, in which the resolution passed by the General Assembly and the Security Council was contested in the court. It was held by the court that undoubtedly the court does not possess the power of judicial review or appeal. in respect of the decision taken by UN organs. So Security Council in this particular case has taken a decision validly adopting from a procedural point of view the resolution for requesting the advisory opinion in front of International Court of Justice. So as held in this case that the court does not do the work of judicial review or appeal in regards to the
counsel. Was the matter referred to climate change of UN before referring to the security ICJ?
If Your Excellency is
was the matter referred to the intergovernmental panel, that is the Apex UN body on the climate change? Was the matter referred to or discussed in that forum before referring to the ICJ?
There has been nothing mentioned about that in the compromise, Your Excellencies, about the reference of the matter in the climate change forum. But the Republic of Moldova did propose a resolution to refer the matter to the International Court of Justice, which was slightly a different question to the question that was proposed by the Security Council. Furthermore, the resolution was validly adopted from the procedural point of view. It has been explicitly mentioned in paragraph number 20 of the fact sheet that this opinion, so we can rightly assume that the word decided means it was validly adopted from a procedural point of view inside the Security Council.
Council, is it an issue that was discussed at the General Assembly and defeated? Repeated in a sense, they failed to pass a resolution. And the same matter is taken up by the Security Council and asking the advisory opinion of the ICJ. The Council is, do you actually consider this as a way of reviewing the decision of the General Assembly?
Presented in the General Assembly by Republic of Moldova is first of all, it's not exactly the same question which has been presented by the Security Council. But the question presented, it's not like...
It says it's a slightly amended one, that is what you are going to say.
That. Yes, Mr. President.
But is it a right to review where the General Assembly would have gone wrong?
Mr. President, we have to look at how the Security Council functions in the real world. As mentioned in the compromise and also mentioned by the Secretary General of the United Nations, the issue of climate change and transboundary migration has posed a serious threat to international peace and security. The issue of reviewing the decision of General Assembly it's not important here. The Security Council has not done it, but realizing the importance of the issue, the particular question which was defeated in the General Assembly, it was later amended with suitable amendments. It was presented in the Security Council. The Security Council has a special mandate to request advisory opinion and the maintenance of peace and security. With saying this, what we should not forget is the advisory opinion is not of a binding character. It's just a guidance for the states and the requesting organ and the United Nations as a whole. So if Security Council requests a particular advisory opinion to the court, then it is for the betterment of the policies to be formed inside the United Nations and between the states. There is still ample space for the states and the United Nations as a whole to discuss on the matter even after this International Court of Justice has delivered its advisory opinion. If I may proceed.
No. If the advisory opinion has been sought, okay, and you say that it is not binding, then what is the purpose? Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So aren't they sufficient? I think the republics must have ratified all these treaties or the conventions.
Republic of Hindustan has not ratified the 1951 convention, but it has ratified other important human rights convention.
Human rights convention, okay. But then if the advisory opinion is not going to be binding, so what is the idea?
Your Excellencies, the most important thing we need to focus here is that the advisory opinion is given to the requesting organ. In this particular case, if the court indeed decides to give advisory opinion, then the Security Council will have a clearer view of how they should proceed. But what the value of advisory opinion in the real world is, it has a great value. It does have a great value. It does not have a binding value. But if you look at the history of
persuasive value.
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
Okay, continue please.
So lastly, in conferring on Security Council primary responsibility for maintenance of international peace and security, the members of organization, as mentioned in UN Charter, agree that it act on their behalf. So the council thus acts as the agent for all the members and not independently of their wishes. In regards to my third contention, which is that the question presented before the court is a legal one. It has been held in the nuclear weapon case that the issue of, in that particular case, the issue of legality or threat or use of nuclear weapons was concerned. The court analyzed in that particular case that the court needs to identify existing principles and rules, interpret them, and apply them to the question concerned. So if you look at the question that has been presented before this Honorable Court, it explicitly mentioned the extent of responsibility of states to offset the social and human impact of climate change based on the established principles of international environmental law, mainly the precautionary principle and the principle of transboundary harm. So we can rightly conclude that the question before the court is a legal one, and the issues that has been put forward by the Security Council does involve a legal character. And as held in Western Sahara case, according to the court, as mentioned in this case, legal questions are those that have been framed in terms of law and raise problems of international law.
Has precautionary principle been followed?
In this particular
yes.
case?
Yes. In this particular problem that we have before us?
Yes. The question presented is that the court should apply the principle of environmental law, that is the precautionary principle.
But did the court apply?
Sorry, Your Excellency.
Finally, did the court refer to it?
If you may repeat the question.
Okay. No, refer, was the precautionary principle the basis of the court's decision?
Not in this case I was referring to, but it was a different legal question that was presented, but the court concluded that a serious problems of international law or serious legal dilemma or lacuna has to be there for rendering advisory opinion. My second broad argument, if I may proceed, and there are no compelling reasons for the court to prevent the exercise of advisory opinion in the present proceeding. Even when the court has jurisdiction to render an advisory opinion, it still has a discretionary power under Article 65(1) of the statute to refuse to exercise its competence. It was held in the construction of wall case and the nuclear weapon case as well, but the discretionary power to decide decline a request for an advisory opinion should be used exceptionally only when there are compelling reasons. What we should not forget is that in rendering advisory opinion, the court is
competent. Could you please tell us, is there any compelling reason in instant case to deliver, to exercise such advisory jurisdiction? What is the compelling reason?
That is indeed a very important question, Your Excellency. the matter that has been referred is posing a serious threat to international peace and security.
How?
It.
On what ground? Dispute arises from arrest of a diplomatic staff who breach of a local criminal law, national law, and then sought shield under Vienna Convention on immunity.
Yes, Your Excellency.
So how a tension between two states can pose an immediate threat to the security, world security? That's you are saying this is the compelling reason. How it triggers? Show us, convince this court that because of this individual incident or incidental activities between two countries, this is escalation in the diplomatic tensions. How it triggered the immediate threat to the international security and peace? That you are pleading as a compelling reason.
Your Excellency, thank you for the question at first, but what the Council would humbly like to differ in this particular case is that only one aspect of the case is in relation to diplomatic staff and his arrest. What we have to look in a broader context is the threat that has been posed due to climate change, due to the increased sea level, and
no, it's criminal activity of a diplomatic staff. That they're just infringing this local law, and that this is purely criminal activity. No direct relation with the climate refugees.
Is the entire diplomatic immunity for this?
Your Excellencies, that particular issue would be dealt by my co-counsel, but...
That's good. That's good.
Okay.
You may carry on, please.
Your Excellency.
The climate doesn't have anything to
do. Please go ahead.
The advisory opinion has been sought by the Security Council in relation to the extent of state responsibility vis-a-vis the effect of climate change. The UN has a special responsibility with respect to climate change and maintenance of international peace and security. There are in fact compelling reasons for the court, as the principal judicial organ of the United Nations, to share the burden of this responsibility by providing in the present case legal guidance to Security Council, the General Assembly as a whole, and the United Nations. Furthermore, the United Nations bears a responsibility with regard to the question, as it is of acute importance to the world peace. The consent of Hindustan in this particular case is not a mandatory thing, as held in the Kosovo case. Advisory opinion is not given to the state but to the requesting organ. And furthermore, advisory opinion will help the UN and member states in their subsequent actions. As there is time constraints, I'd like to conclude my argument saying that the advisory opinion is not a binding action on the parties connected, but merely a guidance for its requesting organ. And UN as a whole, which helps in achieving the ultimate objectives of maintaining international peace and security, the Council humbly submits before this court that the court exercise jurisdiction in this particular case and guide the United Nations as a whole in a proper direction. Thank you. It was an honor reading before this court.
You may be.
Please the court, I'm counsel number 2, appearing on the behalf of the applicant in the case Republic of Moldova versus Republic of Hindustan in the issue of extent of diplomatic immunity vis-a-vis the legality of action of Hindustan in the present changed set of circumstances and scenarios. Your Excellencies, I'll be speaking for the total time of 50 minutes. Your Excellencies, this case has come to this Honorable Court under Article 41 and Article 36(1) of ICC Statute. Now, with the due permission of the bench, I'd like to proceed with my submissions. Thank you. First of all, the Council would like to present the format of the arguments to be submitted over here. There are altogether 3 broad arguments. The first broad argument is Hindustan made grave violations of both treaty and customary international law. The second broad argument is Your Excellencies, Hindustan undermining the remedies available under VCDR acted beyond its jurisdiction, prosecuting the diplomat in its local court. And the third broad argument is until a separate legal regime is designed by the international community to deal with the abuse of immunity by the diplomats, then the actions of Indistan like that of the present case should not be justified on any basis. Your Excellencies, now I would like to present the supporting arguments for my first broad argument, that is, Indistan made grave violations of both treaty and customary international law. Your Excellencies, Indistan violated the crux of VCDI, that is the inviolability principle and immunity of the diplomat from the jurisdiction of the host state. Your Excellencies, the police agency of Republic of Indistan along with an NGO encroached the inviolability of the first, private residence of the diplomat, and second, the physical privilege to personal inviolability of the diplomat by arresting him in the airport. Your Excellencies, under VCDR, being a party to VCDR, Indistan has a prime responsibility to treat the members of the diplomatic mission with due respect and take all appropriate steps to prevent any attack on their person, freedom, and dignity. Your Excellencies, but in this case, it violated this physical privilege to personal inviolability of the diplomat by arresting him in the airport. Moreover, it impaired the right of the diplomat to be immune from the jurisdiction of the host state. VCDR in its Article 31 clearly stated the right of the diplomatic agent to be immune from the criminal jurisdiction of the receiving state. Your Excellencies, as an exception.
I have a question. What about when there is a violation of human rights? There are already so many charters, okay, which have been ratified by the republics. So Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So there's a violation of human rights of the people who are working in the diplomat's house. So how can you say that, you know,
Also, yes. I'm supplementing, ma'am.
Yes.
Also, if you see any contradiction between privilege and legal duty, which one shall prevail in your eye?
Much obliged, Your Excellencies. I am dealing with these two specific topics in my preceding arguments. Would that be okay?
Yes.
Thank you, Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, Republic of Indistan in this case not only arrested the diplomatic official but also initiated the proceedings against him in local court, which violates the right of the diplomatic agent. Your Excellencies, as ruled by ICJ in US diplomatic and consular staffs in Tehran case, this constitutes a grave breach of obligations by Indistan. Also, in DRC versus Belgium case, the arrest warrant in the name of the incumbent foreign minister for the grave breaches of Geneva Convention 1949, it has been held that it is the failure of Belgium to respect the immunity of the foreign minister, Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, it provides a strong basis that prosecution of the diplomat was illegal, irrespective of the grounds for the prosecution. Your Excellencies, with regard to the question presented by Your Excellency, with regard to the question of human rights violations, Your Excellencies, the Council would like to draw the attention of this honorable bench and the fact that human right indeed is a very important matter of international law that the UN has been dealing it consequently after the Second World War. Your Excellencies, what the Council would like to point out in this submission is that the contention of the applicant is not that diplomats should be given the immunity to violate the human rights. It's not the contention of applicant in this very case. The contention of applicant in this very case is that the procedure which has been set out in the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations as a lex specialis has not been followed. Your Excellencies, this indeed has a very grave consequences in the field of international relations, because Your Excellencies, the international relation in practice, not in theory, in practice it operates on the...
The this is not only the violation of the human rights from this trade and supporting the exercise, it's a serious local criminal offense against child and women. And the host state is responsible to perform its obligation towards international treaties with high conflicting parties. In one side, it is local law, local obligation as part of the CRPC offense. Another side, it gives a greater degree of responsibility towards its international obligation by virtue of treaties, covenant, signed.
Much obliged, Your Excellencies. This is indeed a very important question. Your Excellencies, yes, the applicant agrees that Hindustan is with an obligation to protect the rights of the diplomat, protect the rights of the victims of human rights. But Your Excellencies, there are special procedures set out in the VCDR. And VCDR is not only just a treaty, but a customary international law. It is the codification of long recognized customary international law in the international relations. And Your Excellencies...
Then another short point. If you see the contradiction between customary international law and national law, what will prevail? Tell us. Give one example at least.
Thank you for your question, Your Excellencies. Of course, if there is a contradiction between the customary international law and national law, the customary international law prevails, Your Excellencies. But in this very case, there have been set out the remedies for the violation of the abuse of immunity by the diplomat clearly in VCDR. That is, in case of serious crimes, Your Excellencies, persona non grata can be declared, or a diplomat can be declared persona non grata and sent back home. Your Excellencies, in US versus Iran case, the ICJ has clearly stated that the VCDR 1961 in itself is a self-contained regime that sets out the immunities and privileges of the diplomats, as well as, Your Excellencies, it sets out the means of disposal for the abuse of immunity by the diplomats, that is persona non grata, Your Excellencies. Moreover, Your Excellencies, it could allow Mandova to try the diplomat. The contention of Mandova is not that the diplomat should not be tried at all. It is a democratic country. It is a democratic country. It has signed human rights instruments, CRC, CEDAW, and many other instruments. And the contention is only that it violated the procedure because it is having a grave consequence in the international relation, because the international relation operates on the principle of reciprocity. I'd like to give an example to that. After the raid of Nicaraguan ambassador's residence in Panama City, followed by apology from US, Your Excellencies, the US apologized for the raid immediately after. Still, Nicaragua retaliated by expelling 20 US diplomats, Your Excellencies.
But it's not a judicial example, Your Counsel. Give us a judicial example.
Your Excellencies, judicial example of exactly, could you please repeat the question again?
Yeah. No, this sort of relation between Nicaragua and United States towards each other. Give us a judicial example.
Exactly, Your Excellencies. The main point the applicant is arguing, is trying to put here is not all the cases of the immunity of diplomats go to ICC, Your Excellencies. The question, the point here is countries do not always go to ICJ in the violations or in the abuse of diplomatic immunities under VCDR. That means it does not always function in the judicial level. This, in fact, in the real world, is operated within the countries on the basis of mutual interest of states, Your Excellencies.
They are European and British examples.
Your Excellencies, if you are referring to the European...
But you may carry on because of time to spend. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellencies.
Okay. Finally, I just posted that all the provisions in the Vienna Convention can be considered as part of customary international law. All the provisions do have made reference to Article 31. So all the articles you consider in the Convention can be considered as part of customary international law.
Much obliged, Your Excellency.
And one more, I would like to add that then Canada's immunity can be made use of by the diplomat for the in their private capacity, or is there any functional objective or whatever?
Much obliged, Your Excellencies. That is indeed a very important question, because all the provisions in VCDR are not customary international law. Your Excellencies, there has been incorporated some progressive provisions too. And with regard to the second question, that is the functional necessity principle, that is indeed a very correct thing that the court has stated. The functional necessity principle is the crux of VCDR, Your Excellencies. The contention of the applicant is not on that, because, but, Your Excellencies, as well as the functional necessity principle is a theoretical principle, because I already gave an example that the principle of international relation specially and most importantly operates in the principle of reciprocity, Your Excellencies. Since just to diplomats, but also to the expatriate community, examples in the history can be taken as there are examples where the reporters are taken as hostages in the act of retaliation, also teachers and librarians murdered in retaliation to the acts relating to diplomatic agents. Your Excellencies.
Okay.
I would like to humbly ask one more minute to conclude my argument. Okay. Thank you. Your Excellencies, VCDR as a cornerstone in the modern international order functions on the basis of principle of reciprocity, and it has very grave consequences in the international relations. So actions like that of Indistan might seem reasonable from just the point of view of an ordinary person, not from the point of view of this honorable court, which understands the international relation principle, that is the theory of reciprocity, in detail. Therefore, I would like to request the Honorable Court to declare the actions of Indistan illegal according to the international law. Thank you. It was an honor pleading before this court.
Thank you. Respondents, ready? Ben is ready to give time. Give him a moment.
The agents for the respondent, you hereby express our due respect. Good day, Mr. President and Your Excellencies. I am Agent R1, representing respondent, and along with my co-agent R2, and we shall be representing respondents in the case of Republic of Moldova and Republic of KHS versus Republic of Indistan. Your Excellency, the agents for the respondent would like to put forth before this honorable court three important issues, mainly. First one, the court does not have the jurisdiction to render its advisory opinion as requested by the Security Council, and also lacks the power to club two cases. Secondly, the arrest of the diplomat is in accordance with the international law. And thirdly, Your Excellencies, Republic of Indistan has protected the basic dignity and liberty of the victims from Republic of KHS. Your Excellencies, of these three issues, the first two issues shall be dealt by my co-agent, and she shall be taking 70 minutes of your time, and the last and final issue shall be dealt by myself, and I shall be taking 15 minutes of your time. With Your Excellency's kind permission, may the agent start. Much obliged, Your Excellencies. The issue that the agent shall be dealing is that Republic of Indistan has protected the basic dignity and liberty of the victims from Republic of KHS. Your Excellencies, the agent for the respondents would like to point out that this is a main underlying issue in this case, in this current case. And we would further like to point out that the agents for the applicants have not even considered about this case. Your Excellencies, if I may continue, the right to life, we agree that is protected in both UDHR and ICCPR. Article 3 of UDHR do give that everyone has the right to life and liberty and security of a person, and so does it, and so is the same form given in ICCPR. But Your Excellency, what is to be noted here is that the rights and liberties given to the victims of KHS can only be given concerning them as simple trafficked victims, and they cannot be given the status of refugees. To enumerate my point, may the agent, with your kind permission, divide her argument into two sets of sub-issues. Much obliged, Your Excellencies. The first sub-issue is that Republic of Indistan has falsely accused KHS because the victims cannot be considered as climate refugees. And the second sub-issue is that Republic of Indistan has not failed to uphold state responsibility. Your Excellency, our Convention of Treaties 1969 strictly gives that a person need not, that is a state need not...
Council, you are admitting they are not climate refugee.
Indeed, yes.
What is their identity? And a status? They are stateless.
Your Excellency, they can be called as illegal immigrants, and further, they can be considered as trafficked person, because it is given very clearly in the statement of facts, paragraph...
Are they economic migrants?
Your Excellency, not all of them are economic migrants. The case...
No, these two victims.
Your Excellency, these two victims cannot be considered...